Our beautiful outdoor service today, and thank God for the weather again. It's been beautiful the couple times we've done this. My name is Dan Slusser. I'm one of the elders here at SBC, and I've just got a couple of announcements for everybody. One is the ABFs and the Sunday school, Children's Sunday School, are all back. So 9:15, if you want to come, we are doing it safely. If you have any questions about a class to join or any other things like that, call the church office. Trunk or Treat. This year our church is participating in the Highland Trunk or Treat at Main Square Park. It's October 24th from 2 to 5. Our outreach committee is looking for people interested in decorating the SBC trunk and to represent our church. They need help setting up the trunk on the 24th, passing out candy, snacks, and tracts, sharing the event about our faith, and that if that opportunity does arise. So you can donate candy, and you can certainly pray for this event. If you have any questions, please contact Scott Falvey. I'll turn it back over to the worship team. Thank you.
Why, thank you, Dan. Dan Slusser, the chairman of our elder board, ladies and gentlemen, who hates public speaking. How are we doing this morning? Good? What time is it? Somebody give me the time. Church time, right? Amen. So we always kind of like start with a Bible verse, but how come we always have to come up with the Bible verses? Why don't you guys come up with the Bible verses? So somebody, give me your favorite Bible verse. What does it say?
Trust in the Lord.
There you go. Amen. Anybody got another one they like? Nobody? Amen. Amen. Absolutely. Good. All right. Well, are we ready to worship this morning? All right. Why don't you stand with us? I know the screen might be kind of hard to see, but we're just going to have to deal with it.
Their hands today so they can shield their eyes.
The cross before me, the world behind, no turning back, raise a banner high, it's not for me, it's all. Shaking, the mountains shouting.
Amen. Somebody give me another Bible verse. Absolutely. I think there's a submission verse in there too somewhere.
Oh.
Wives, be subject to your husbands.
One day when heaven is filled with His praises, one day when sin was as black as could be, Jesus came forth to be born of a virgin, dwelt among men, my example is He. The Word became flesh and the light shined out. Could not keep him.
Amen. Give me another Bible verse. Amen. Amen. Anybody got another one? I'm going to start calling on people in a minute.
Who breaks the power of sin and darkness? Whose love is mighty and so much stronger? The King of glory, the King above all kings. shakes the whole earth with holy thunder, who leaves us breathless in awe and wonder. The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. King of glory, who rules the nations with truth and justice, shines like a sun, all of his brilliance. The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place.
Amen. Amen. You may be seated. Let me pray for us, you guys. Heavenly Father, Lord, we want to thank you for our time together in worship, Lord, and to just go through your word and to be together. We pray that that your word would be powerful today, Lord, that your Holy Spirit would be upon Pastor Adam as he delivers the message, Lord, for us that you have us to deliver. We want to thank you for such a wonderful family here that we have. We want to give you all the praise and the glory. In your name we pray. Amen.
Welcome to the parking lot of Suburban Bible Church. It's nice to see all your bright, smiley, squinting faces this morning. And I just want you to know that you are all given a test this morning. We had lined up the metal chairs on the side in rows, and you're tested to see how well you could do at staying with the rows, and you all failed. It's a beautiful morning, isn't it? I can't think of a more perfect temperature or just feel for the morning. It'd be nice if there was a little bit more breeze or maybe a little bit more shade from clouds. I didn't wear sunscreen today, so we need to hurry this along so I don't get a sunburn. But anyway, this morning we're going to be continuing in our verse-by-verse study through the book of Philippians as we learn again from Paul how to find joy in all circumstances. I've been thinking about this as we've been going through this series, and I've been wondering if this series would have been better titled Joy in Spite of Circumstances. Now, that doesn't quite roll off the tongue, and I think the joy in all circumstances conveys the essence of what we see in Paul in this book, in this short letter, because what we see again, time and time again, is that Paul really did find joy. He found joy not in spite of his circumstances, but really because of them. Because he had this mindset, as we talked about last week, where he saw all things in light of his mission. He was so focused on preaching the gospel, so focused on proclaiming Christ to the world, that he was able to see his circumstances in the correct light, as opportunities that God was giving him to point people to Jesus. In prison, in chains, in wealth, in poverty, in sickness, in health, all things could be seized upon in order to make much of Christ, to make Christ known. And this morning, we're going to look more at this attitude, that Paul's attitude that he had, what it revealed about his heart, and hopefully what we can learn for ourselves as well, to understand about our relationship with Christ. For Paul, his relationship with Christ, his identity, it's what motivated his commitment to the mission of the gospel. The mission was first in his mind only because of that relationship that he had with Christ and how he understood it, and there's a fed. You see, Paul, he wasn't interested in being wealthy or being comfortable or being famous. He wasn't concerned about external circumstances for the most part. No, he was on mission because of one thing, because of one reason, and that reason was hope. As we're going to see this morning, hope in the Lord. Hope in what the Lord promises in salvation. Hope in seeing that salvation delivered to the fullest. Hope of being one day joyously welcomed into the presence of his Lord and Savior in eternity. It was that hope that motivated and sustained his ministry, that no matter what happened, he knew he had hope. And the fact that his Lord would never fail him. You've probably heard this before from many different places, but it's true in Christian life that without hope, life is meaningless. Hope is the most powerful motivator for life and godliness, for taking action that there is. We all need hope. We all need to hope in the Lord, if we're to live this life that God has called us to live. We need to understand this as well so we are better able to communicate that hope that we have, the hope of salvation. And so this morning, if you haven't already, I'd encourage you to open your Bibles to Philippians chapter 1, and there will be no slides on the screen next to me. But open your Bibles to Philippians chapter 1, and we're going to see or begin to see the hope that inspired Paul. Paul was a man who was filled with hope, and his hope allowed him, as we're going to see, to suffer all manner of things, to endure even being in chains for Christ. And so let's see where this hope has been placed. Starting in the last part of verse 18 through verse 20, we read this. Paul says this, "Yes, and I will continue to rejoice, for I know that through your prayers and God's provision of the Spirit of Jesus Christ, what has happened to me will turn out for my deliverance. I eagerly expect and hope that I will in no way be ashamed, but will have sufficient courage so that now, as always, Christ will be exalted in my body, whether by life or by death." So we see here that Paul knows that he has reason to continue to rejoice, as he says here. He's looking to his future. Up until this point, he's been focusing on the past and his present ministry and the fruit of his ministry that he sees in the Philippian church and his present circumstances. But now Paul shifts the focus, begins looking to the future, the joy that he has now, he will continue in. And he will continue in it because of his eager anticipation, as he says here, of his deliverance. So what does that mean? What is he talking about when he says his deliverance? This term here that the NIV translates in deliverance, you may recognize it. It's actually the Greek term soterion, which it also can be translated then as salvation. Deliverance from the wages of sin and death, condemnation. And here, I think that this is the sense that Paul is using here. He's using this term in its salvific sense, saying that he's looking forward to his deliverance in the completion of his salvation. He's speaking about salvation. I believe this is where he's going, because we see later on, starting in verse 23, he starts talking about looking forward to going to heaven to be with Christ. And so, of course, Paul wants to be delivered from his current circumstances. He doesn't want to be in prison. The context here is Paul's talking about the future. Paul has confidence in the fact that his eventual deliverance, that the completion of his salvation, will mean that he will be united with his Lord in heaven. And in that deliverance, Paul is convinced then that his enemies will be proven wrong, that at that day he will stand before Christ in heaven, vindicated, revealing that his hope had not been in vain. Which is why he says here that he has confidence, that he eagerly expects and hopes that he will no way be ashamed. Right here, when he's talking about being ashamed, he's not talking about a personal concept of shame. He's not talking about that he hopes that he doesn't stumble so much or make a mistake and somehow is then ashamed of himself. Instead, this carries the idea of being put to shame by the actions of another. And so what Paul is saying here is that because his hope and his trust and his confidence are in Christ, he knows that he will never be put to shame in his faith. Not because of himself, but because of Christ. The faithfulness of Christ is why he knows he will never be put to shame. Because of the faithfulness of Christ, Paul trusts that he will have the courage to endure, to live, or to die as a true Christian. To live or die in the ministry of the gospel to which he and all of us are called. Because of the faithfulness of Christ, his circumstances don't matter to him except that they help him in his ministry. And through it all, he's encouraged in his circumstances because of his confidence that God would not shame him, that his faith would mean that he is delivered, that God was indeed his God, and that his circumstances were all part of God's plan and Paul's faithful service. Ultimately, Paul eagerly expected and placed his hope in his Lord's triumph over all evil, his deliverance. Psalm 25:2. I trust in you. Do not let me be put to shame, nor let my enemies triumph over me. This is what probably was going through Paul's head when he was writing this, because in the grand scheme of things, continued life or death, these things didn't really matter to Paul, because neither his continued imprisonment, nor being set free from prison, nor even being executed for his faith, none of this would mean that God had abandoned him. Instead, death, continued life, imprisonment, release, all of these things, each of them, no matter what, they would all prove his faith, that his faith was warranted, that it was true, that his Lord was faithful. Paul's circumstances didn't matter because his hope was in his deliverance at the end. The promised salvation that awaited him in eternity. In fact, his sufferings, his imprisonment, what had happened to him, this would all serve to prove or to display the faithfulness of God in the face of his enemies. Again, the psalmist in Psalm 94:14, for the Lord will not reject his people. He will never forsake his inheritance. The mission is to make Christ known, And in that, Paul was confident that his Lord would be faithful and that his promised deliverance would show that faithfulness. This morning, this is our hope as well. See, friends, the motivation when things get difficult is not that they will eventually get better, at least in this life. The motivation, the hope that we have in Christ, that hope is the completion of our salvation when we are united with our Lord in eternity. When all the suffering that we've endured in this world will appear as light and momentary in light of the weight of His glory. This is what we look forward to, the hope of our deliverance. And when we understand this, as Paul is going to get into more depth later, when we understand this, this gives us the motivation that we need to be faithful in the circumstances of life, no matter where they may take us. But Paul knew that his deliverance, his salvation, that sufficient courage to endure his present sufferings, that these things, they weren't going to be accomplished in his own power. Paul wasn't the one who was going to save himself or encourage himself in these things. He understood that these things were promised, yes, but they were promised also to be provided through two distinct means that he mentions here. Those means are prayer and the Holy Spirit. First, prayer. Paul was a man of prayer. Paul was a man who understood the importance of prayer. All throughout his writings, Paul shows that he realized the importance of prayer in faithful Christian life. But he's not just talking about his own prayer. He's also talking about the faithful prayers, the intercessory prayers of his brothers and sisters in Christ. He understood that prayer is a vital component of spiritual life. He doesn't think that his salvation was dependent upon the prayers of others. No, but what Paul is talking about here is intercessory prayer, prayers of encouragement, prayers of strengthening, prayers of endurance, prayers of faithfulness. Because he understood that God chooses to work in the world through the means of answering the prayers of his people. And Paul understood this, and this is why he so often prayed for others in this way. For example, in 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verses 4 through 9, this is an extended prayer that Paul prays. He says this, "I always thank my God for you because of his grace given you in Christ. For in him you have been enriched in every way, with all kinds of speech, with all knowledge, God thus confirming our testimony about Christ among you. Therefore, you do not lack any spiritual gift as you eagerly wait for our Lord Jesus Christ to be revealed. He will also keep you firm to the end so that you will be blameless on the day of our Lord Jesus Christ. God is faithful, who has called you into fellowship with his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord." See, Paul here is praying an intercessory prayer of strength, of encouragement for the Corinthian church. Sometimes we may forget this, but it's the case that so much of our individual Christian lives, that sanctification, that courage, that endurance under suffering, that these things, they're not just a part of our private relationship between me and God. These things are meant to be understood corporately as well, within our fellowship together as believers. And Paul knew this, which is why he coveted the prayers of others. Friends, we need to be praying for our brothers and sisters in Christ, and we need the prayers of our brothers and sisters in Christ lifted up to God on our behalf, especially in times of trial, in times of difficult circumstance where maybe we don't have the mental or emotional energy to know how to pray for ourselves. Paul says this in 2 Corinthians chapter 1, verses 10 and 11. "He has delivered us from such a deadly peril, and he will deliver us again. On him we have set our hope that he will continue to deliver us as you help us by your prayers. Then many will give thanks on our behalf for the gracious favor God granted us in answer to the prayers of many. And so we have to ask ourselves then, how are we doing in prayer? How well are we doing in praying for each other? Especially when we know that someone is going through a difficult time. Prayer is so important precisely because we are called and equipped to do life together as a church, as a fellowship, as a community. And I get it. Sometimes it seems like prayer maybe is unimportant, or that my prayers really don't matter in the grand scheme of things. Because God already knows what's going on. He already knows what's happening. He already knows what he's going to do. But he works in the world so often through the prayers, again, of his people. Prayer is important. The prayer of a righteous man availeth much, even if we don't see it ourselves. And so maybe if you sometimes struggle to pray for your brothers and sisters, as I sometimes do, the thing that can help us to understand the significance of prayer is to ask yourself, who do I know who is missing out on blessing and encouragement because I'm not praying for them? Because again, prayer is the means by which God works in our lives to provide what we need to serve him. And the means is then brought to life, as Paul says here, through the presence and the power of the Holy Spirit. Provision to endure, remain encouraged, and even receiving the ultimate deliverance of salvation. These all come through the work of the Holy Spirit. It's not that the Holy Spirit comes and goes, that his presence is tied to our prayers. No, we know we can have confidence that the indwelling presence of the Holy Spirit is always with us. The moment of conversion and remains throughout our life. Ephesians 1, 13 and 14. And you also were included in Christ when you heard the message of truth, the gospel of your salvation. When you believed, you were marked in him with a seal, the promised Holy Spirit, who is a deposit guaranteeing our inheritance until the redemption of those who are God's possession to the praise of his glory. See, what Paul is talking about here in our passage this morning is the ministry of the Holy Spirit, the provision that God gives us. He's talking about that specific provision that's often provided through, again, the means of prayer. And this helps me to understand this. We have to remember the reason why God works through the prayers of his people, the reason why God answers prayer, responds to prayer, blesses us, provides for us so often through prayer, is because God is a person. Our God is a personal God, and he listens to and he answers those prayers relationally through the presence and the working of the Holy Spirit in our lives. God wants relationship with us. He wants us to come to him. He wants us to talk to him. He wants us to ask him for what we need, to ask him for what our brothers and sisters in need when we see them in distress. The presence and the working of the Holy Spirit in our lives. This is relationship. This is God gracing us with what we need when we ask for it in faith. For example, James 1, 5, if any of you lacks wisdom, you should ask God, who gives generously to all without finding fault, and it will be given to you. See, the presence of the Spirit is always with believers. We always have the indwelling presence of the Holy Spirit in our lives, but isn't it true that we're not always as aware of it as we should be? Especially if we're in sin, or if we're focused on our circumstances, if we're focused on what's going on, if we're focused on the world too much. That's why prayer is so important. It's actually a gift given us by God, because prayer orients us back onto God. It centers us on where we need to be, pursuing Him, knowing Him better, learning His will, His purposes. See, friends, Paul is confident. He's assured. He's hopeful in spite of the suffering that most of us couldn't even imagine happening in our own lives. He's hopeful because he's focused on Christ. Not on himself, not on his circumstances. He's focused on Christ. And he remained focused on Christ through his prayer, through the prayers of his brothers and sisters in Christ. And this commitment to prayer, in turn, made him more aware of that relationship that he had with God, made him more aware of the presence and the empowerment of the Spirit in his life. And all of this then in turn is what gave him confidence. Because his hope wasn't in what was going on in his life. It wasn't in the trajectory that he sees the world going in. His hope was on his deliverance, on that day of salvation being complete, when he is once again in the presence of his Lord and Savior. And that's why he was able to find joy. His hope, our hope, needs to be in what's to come. Paul's future-oriented focus continues then in our next section. Verses 21 through 26, we read this. For me, to live is Christ, and to die is gain. If I am to go on living in the body, this will mean fruitful labor for me. Yet what shall I choose? I do not know. I am torn between the two. I desire to depart and be with Christ, which is better by far. But it is more necessary for you that I remain in the body. Convinced of this, I know that I will remain, and I will continue with all of you for your progress and joy in the faith, so that through my being with you again, your boasting in Christ Jesus will abound on account of me. And so for many of us, I know for me, most of the time when I read this, my focus just naturally jumps to verse 21, because Paul does something here on purpose. He reverses the expected order that we think of, this relationship between living and dying. For a Christian, you might sometimes think, hey, dying is Christ, right? Because in dying, I get to go be with Christ. But Paul is saying here, for a Christian, it's that in living that you are in Christ. And in dying, you find gain, reward. And so this mindset is flipped. He flips the switch here. And we need to understand why he flips the switch here, because we need to understand how Paul can have, again, this joy, this hope, this eager anticipation for the future. And so first, he talks about living. Paul says that to live is Christ, meaning that Paul understood the manner in which he lived matters. He lived to glorify Christ above all else. And so as we're going to see, Paul understood that to continue in the flesh, to continue living, meant continued service in the kingdom. It meant that more people would be pointed to Christ because of his life, his words, his actions, his current circumstances, being in chains for Christ. All of these things could be used by Christ in order to point people to Christ. Paul knew that his life belonged to Christ, and so his continuing living was granted to him by Jesus for his purposes, not for Paul's. And so for him to live is Christ. And yet, even though he knew that continued life would mean continued service, continued opportunities for Christ in the kingdom, in gospel ministry. At the same time, Paul realized that something far greater awaited him. You realize that something far greater than this world awaits all of us. Dying is gain. Not that you should be eager for death, not that Paul was eager for death, and he's not talking about committing suicide or putting himself in intentionally dangerous situations to try to shorten his time in this life. No, instead he knew that in death he would gain, because he would experience an even closer and more intimate relationship with his Lord, because he would be in Christ's presence in heaven. And if he was called to die for Christ, then his death would magnify Christ all the more, because it would reveal to the world that he understood that Christ was worthy of dying for. Again, talking about suffering and even death, Peter says this in 1 Peter 3:14, "But even if you should suffer for what is right, you are blessed. Do not fear their threats. Don't be frightened." To live is Christ. To die is gain. And it's this mindset. This is even a dilemma that all Christians have to face. Because there's within us, if we understand this, then there's within us these two competing longings. The longing to remain in the flesh and be of useful service in the kingdom. And the longing to go home to be with your Lord in heaven. And it's not really a dilemma, but it just kind of seems so, because when it gets down to it, both of these things are good. Serving God is good. Being in God's presence is good. And ultimately, the tension is not really something that we can ever resolve, because we're not meant to. Because this tension helps motivate us in ministry. And so first, Paul acknowledges a very real longing for Christ, a strong desire to be in the presence of our Lord and Savior, maybe even motivated by wanting to end the pain and suffering that he was experiencing in the moment. But as Christians, as we grow in our understanding of, as we grow in our relationship with Christ, our longing to be with him is going to grow as well. As we experience his goodness, his blessings more and more in our lives, as we grow more and more like him through the sanctifying work of the Spirit in our lives, we will desire more and more to experience the completion of our salvation in heaven with Christ. And again, this isn't a death wish. It's not even a desire to end the pain and suffering. What this is, when you come down to it, this is a desire to experience life to the fullest, to receive the fullness, the completion, to enjoy the promised relationship with God in heaven by being welcomed into his presence. There's a longing in our souls to experience Christ in this way. And there should be, because when you get down to it, this is the greatest possible experience that anyone could ever have. Psalm 119:81, "My soul faints with longing for your salvation, but I put my hope in your word." And it's true that in this life we can and we do experience Christ's presence in many ways, especially again through the indwelling presence of the Spirit. This isn't the fullness that we're promised. This isn't the fullness for which we long. And because of this, then, there is a good and God-honoring longing for him, a desire of the soul that can only be satisfied when we are in the presence of our Lord in heaven. And so for a Christian, it is definitely true that dying is gain. And yet at the same time, to remain in the flesh, to remain in this life, this is a good thing as well. Because again, it allows us to serve Him, to serve the gospel. And so for Christians, as we grow again in our understanding and our relationship with Christ, our longing to serve Him also grows along with it. As we're more conformed to His image and likeness, especially to His example of sacrificial giving love, we will desire to live out this sanctification in our lives and ministry in the world. And so a mature and growing Christian understands that one of the blessings of Christian life, one of the blessings of being in God, with God, in this relationship with Christ in this world, is service. That God gives us work, responsibility, mission, that is eternal significance and earns us eternal rewards. See, we're not meant to just receive the Spirit and then sit idly by and wait. See, even at the very beginning, God revealed that He had created us with meaning and purpose. He told Adam and Eve to be fruitful and multiply, fill the earth. And He gave them stewardship in this world. And all of this means that for Christians, fruitful labor in this world, in the church, it should be our heartfelt desire and goal. As Jesus paints this picture in Luke 10:2, the harvest is plentiful, but the workers are few. Ask the Lord of the harvest, therefore, to send out workers into His harvest field. As long as we're in the body, we have opportunity to serve the gospel. That we have the chance to be fruitful, to preach Christ more and more, that more and more people would come to know Him through the ministry that He has given us. To live is Christ. When Paul was writing this, maybe he was perhaps thinking of Psalm 71:18. Even when I am old and gray, do not forsake me, my God, till I declare your power to the next generation, your mighty acts to all who are to come. To live is Christ. To die is gain. And so, like Paul, all who believe in Christ, all who serve in His kingdom, we're faced with this tension between these two good things. What should I choose? That's what Paul says here. What should I choose? He's torn between these two things. The fact that living is for Christ and dying is gain. He's torn between them because he sees the benefit in both. Fruitful service in the world. Being in Christ's presence in eternity. Both good. So which one should he prefer more? Which one should he focus on? So he's more than likely not saying here that God is actually giving him a choice at this point. There's no indication that Paul has been given a choice by God to either continue in ministry or to go into his presence in heaven. It's more that Paul is expressing the desires of his heart. He's talking through his longings. And he gives us then a glimpse of his own heart, which helps us to know where our heart should be as well. Being torn between these two things is in and of itself a good thing in the life of a Christian. It's a blessing from God because it's in longing for Christ that we find the motivation for fruitful ministry while we're still in the flesh. See, in Paul's writings, we've seen him throughout that he's confident in the fact as long as he can have fruitful ministry in the flesh, that he will remain living. He actually desires to remain in this life in spite of his circumstances because he knows that his life can accomplish more and more for the kingdom. He's an evangelist. He's the model evangelist for all of us in the church today. And because his heart was for the lost, especially for the Gentiles and for his fellow Israelites, we see that he's willing to forgo blessings, even postpone his reunion with Christ in heaven, if it meant that he could tell more people about Jesus. In fact, as we've talked about before, he goes so far to say that he's willing to lay aside his own salvation if it meant that his fellow Israelites could come to Christ. Romans 9, 1 through 3, I speak the truth in Christ. I am not lying. My conscience confirms it through the Holy Spirit. I have great sorrow and unceasing anguish in my heart, for I could wish that I myself were cursed and cut off from Christ for the sake of my people, those of my own race. And though this isn't possible, Paul used this desire, his longing for Christ, to motivate his own ministry. Because he wanted everyone to know Christ in the same way that he did, to have the same experience of the awesome goodness, the merciful love, the holy splendor and grace that he himself had received in salvation. Romans 10:1, brothers and sisters, my heart's desire and prayer to God for the Israelites is that they may be saved. As long as there is fruitful ministry for me, my desire should be to remain in the flesh. And my longing for the Lord should motivate me to share his gospel more and more, to more and more people so that they can know the Lord in the same way, experience the same goodness and grace and mercy and love and holiness and glory and awesomeness that I experience in my relationship with him. Because as Paul goes on to explain in these last two verses, verses 25 and 26, again, we're given ministry for a purpose. Our focus in life and ministry, it shouldn't be on ourselves, but on those to whom we are called and equipped to minister. See, Paul is convinced that he still has ministry opportunities because he knows the Philippian church. He knows the other churches that he has ministered to. He knows that they still could benefit from his continued life and example and ministry. And that's why Paul expresses his confidence here that he's going to remain living, that he's going to be delivered, that he will continue in ministry. He's confident not in himself. He's not talking about his abilities or his skill at preaching or persuading others. It's not his ministry efforts that inspire his confidence. Paul's confidence is in the Lord. He is confident, he's assured that the Lord will use him for his brothers and sisters. Because here Paul understands what we all need to remember as well. Our lives are not our own. We've been bought with a price. Paul knew that he had been entrusted with the responsibility of service. The same responsibility that all Christians everywhere are entrusted with, serving God's will in the world, meeting the needs of your brothers and sisters in Christ, preaching the gospel in the world. No matter what happens, no matter what we're called to experience and endure, we can know that this is all for God's purposes. And in this, Paul was following the example of Christ. Shows that he was willing to put the needs of his own or of his brothers and sisters ahead of his own. And look where he ends here. Same place he began. Joy. Paul's joy, the joy of the Philippian church. It's the joy of relationship with Christ. It's not a joy based, again, on circumstances. It's not about the blessings on physical health or wealth. No. True and lasting joy. The only reliable joy we have in this world is found in Christ, not us. And Paul is joyous because he is working towards the joy of this church. He is joyous because he knows that his life, that his continued ministry to the Philippian church would bring joy to them as well as they progressed in their faith, in their relationship with Christ, in their understanding of who Christ is and how to honor and serve and love him best through seeing Paul's example of that faithful service. He's joyous because he knew that the Philippian church would see him and rejoice, not that they knew Paul, but because they saw Christ working through Paul. Imprisonment, release, life, death didn't matter in the end, because Paul's salvation, their salvation, our salvation is secure in Christ. And in living in Christ, we can see the glory of God on display. Psalm 115:1, not to us, Lord, not to us, but to your name be the glory because of your love and faithfulness. Living is Christ. Dying is gain. This is the mindset that leads us to true joy in Christian ministry. And it's in longing for that gain, for that reunion with Christ in heaven. This is what gives us hope and motivation to live for Christ in this world. It's keeping your eyes again on that prize. The mission is the gospel. The reward is Christ in eternity. And as you grow in your relationship with Christ, as you come to understand and experience him more, you will grow in your longing for that deliverance that we are all promised, that completion of our salvation in eternity. And again, what we learn from Paul this morning in this passage is that the key to understand this all is to use this longing to motivate our ministry in this world. Living is for Christ. It's to make his name known, to show in others the wonders of Christ, to teach and preach and proclaim, to live in joy. All the actions, everything in our life, for the glory of God. Showing the world in your words, in your actions, just how awesome our God is. Being that salt and light, shining like stars, reflecting the love of God and how you love and serve others and bringing them the good news. Friends, to die is gain, yes, but to live is Christ. We are, each and every one of us, God's handiwork, his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus at the moment of salvation to do the works that God has planned for us since the beginning. Chief of which is to tell the world, your family, your friends, your neighbors, your co-workers, the person standing next to you in line, to tell the world about the love of God in Christ. So we need to be committed. Pray for me. Pray for yourself. Pray for each other that all of us would focus on the hope and find the courage to endure so that we all faithfully proclaim the gospel with joy until we all too are called home to live as Christ. To die is gain. Pray with me. Heavenly Father, this morning as we are enjoying the beauty of your creation, as we've come together to fellowship, God, we are thankful. We're thankful for you. We're thankful for the salvation that you have given us. We're thankful for the salvation that you offer to this world. We are thankful that relationship with you is just that, relationship, that you give us meaning and purpose, that you give us meaning and purpose in relationship with you and in the work that you've given us. God, the blessing of ministry is such a profound and yet humbling blessing at the same time, that you would have us work in your world, that you would give us this message of the gospel to take into the world. It is a profound responsibility. And as we seek to be faithful to that, God, let us look to you. Let us seek your help, your enablement. Let us seek relationship with you, to know you more and more, because as we come to know you better and love you more, we can more joyously proclaim your love to this world. God, give us a heart and motivation to do that, and help us to always remember to live is for you, to die is to be with you. It's in your Son Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Would you stand with us as we close out our service today? Amen. You guys like meeting outside? Really, it's kind of hot with the sun out, huh? Let me close this in prayer. Heavenly Father, Lord, we just want to thank you for the opportunity to get together, Lord, to meet with you out in public. Lord, we pray that your word would not come back void, Lord, but that it would work in the hearts of all of us here and possibly even, Lord, those listening in. We want to say that we love you. We thank you, Lord, for the unique opportunity we have to present your word, Lord, to those who need to hear it. Jesus, we love you so much. In your holy name we pray. Amen. You're dismissed, church family. Thank you.